Hachette Children's Group presents The Biggest Christmas Secret Ever by L.D. Lapinski. Read for you by Candida Gubbins. Chapter 1. There aren't many people who can burp to the tune of Jingle Bells, but my brother somehow managed it. He even took a bow when he got to the end. Me and Mum stared at him, our expressions somewhere between horrified and impressed.
So, that's what you learnt instead of your GCSE French verbs,
Mum said after a moment.
Time well spent, I think,
said Will, patting his chest as he folded his lanky teenage self into a chair.
I'm going to show Nick when he gets home.
I'm sure he'll be very entertained, Mum said, sipping her coffee. She looked back at her pile of case notes. She'd only been back at work full time for a couple of months, and already it was as though she'd never left. Endless emails about cats who'd got into fights with bigger cats, hamsters who wouldn't eat, and fish that seemed to do nothing but poop pinged onto her tablet constantly, and the pages of notes she brought home in her rucksack never seemed to get any smaller. Mum always said how much she loved her job, but it was hard work being a vet. I'd already made up my mind not to be one. But even with her busy workload, Mum had found time to dive completely into her usual enthusiasm for decorating the house for Christmas. Every year, she dug out handmade baubles, toilet roll angels, and scrunched up paper snowflakes from years gone by. Our boring living room was transformed in the space of a few hours into a grotto of fairy lights, glow-in-the-dark reindeer, and a 7-foot-tall Christmas tree that dominated one corner of the already cramped space. The picture frames on the windowsill were buried beneath glittery fluff that smelled of dust, but was sparklingly festive. Christmas in our house was always the best time of year.
Harper, are you sitting on my wall?
Will asked.
I've told you not to mess with my stuff.
I wouldn't dream of messing with your stuff, I said, rolling my eyes. Don't get your needles in a twist. I stuck it in this carrier bag because it was in the way. Again.
Like your laundry,
Mum added, muttering something about lost socks under her breath. Will ignored us both and grabbed the bag to put it out of my reach. He wasn't as grumpy as he pretended to be. He taught himself to knit a few months ago after watching a video on YouTube, and now could make lumpy, shapeless bags that he claimed were hats or mittens or socks. His big project was a Christmas jumper that he'd started knitting in summer, but still hadn't finished. With December now underway, it looked as though it would have to be a Christmas hanky. Outside, a car's headlights approached, and Mum glanced up expectantly, and then back at her work when the lights passed by. We were all waiting, trying to find something to do without leaving the living room. The TV was on silent, the subtitles scrolling along the bottom of the screen as a chef made caramelized vegetables, so sugar-coated they rolled about in the oven tray like lumps of seaside rock. He's late, I said.
He'll be here, Mum said. He always is, in the end.
It was true. He always was. As if on cue, there was another flash of headlights in the front window, and then a vehicle pulled onto the drive. Will darted over and yanked across the net curtain, enough for me to see a red pickup truck.
He's here.
I told you so. Mum smiled, taking her reading glasses off and fluffing out her blonde hair. There was the sound of keys in the back door, a heavy thud of boots on the kitchen mat, a clunk of a suitcase, and then a booming cry of,
I'm ho-ho-home.
I darted around the sofa and through the door, grinning my head off. Nick stood in the kitchen, hands on his hips, a scarf around his neck and shoulders, a big smile on his bearded face. He was wearing dark blue jeans and heavy black boots, as he always did. His white and grey beard was trim and neat, compared to the flyaway hair on his head that had been haphazardly pulled back into a bun, and the buttons on his red coat were straining to remain fastened over his barrelled torso.
"Harper,"
he said delightedly as soon as he saw me. "Nick!" I went over for a hug, and he lifted me clean off the ground.
"I think you've grown again these past 2 weeks,"
he said after a moment, planting me back on the floor.
"You're always doing that."
"Not as much as Will," I said, looking at my 15-year-old brother, who was creeping into the kitchen, pretending not to be bothered about Nick's arrival, but failing to hide a smile.
"Hey, Nick,"
he managed to drawl.
"Hey, Will."
The two of them bumped fists, and I hid a smirk behind my hand. It would take Will another hour or two to forget about trying to be an adult. Finally, Mum came in, smiling and with her arms stretched out. She and Nick had a big cuddle and a disgusting kiss.
"You're late," she chided as they broke apart.
"You should have seen the traffic,"
Nick said.
"It was fine until we got over the North Sea, and then you wouldn't believe the flocks of migrating birds. The girls had to dodge left and right. Mind you, they were glad to stretch their legs."
"Did you get them all tucked away?" Mum asked.
"Oh, yes. 8 reindeer, all safe and sound at the farm park."
Nick chuckled.
"They were settling down for sleep when I left. The quick flight from Finland was enough to give them a reminder of what's to come in a few weeks."
"I still can't believe we can just talk about all this now," I said happily. "After you two keeping it a secret for so long."
"Well, can you blame us?"
Mum scoffed as Nick laughed. "Imagine if I had told you I was dating Father Christmas the first time you'd met Nick. You never would have believed me. You would have thought I was trying to be funny." "But he is Father Christmas," I cried happily. And it was true. He had the beard, the strength, the reindeer, the sleigh, and the magic. Nick didn't just look like Santa Claus. He was Santa Claus. The real one. The one and only. And it was the biggest secret ever. It had all started the Christmas before last. I'd had my suspicions about Nick straight away because there were plenty of clues. The snowfall that only seemed to land in our garden, and the morning we found a reindeer on the roof. But it was only through some cunning detective work, a few broken promises, and a night I'll never forget that the truth finally came out. We didn't just have a sort of stepdad. We had Stepfather Christmas. Things had gotten interesting after that. Last Christmas, the first one with the secret out in the family, it had been funny rather than mysterious. How there were endless boxes of post for Nick, and how he knew what was inside every wrapped present. I'd hoped for a magical Christmas Eve flight in the sleigh again, helping to deliver a few presents. But that night, there had been torrential rain, so it was too wet for me and Will to join Nick and his reindeer. But then, in the new year, we all got a surprise. There was a sudden wail from a chunky white walkie-talkie on the kitchen counter. The wail quietened off and then turned into a sort of nonsense babble.
"Oh, she's awake,"
Mum said.
"I'll go,"
Nick said, easing past her and heading up the stairs. Me and Will exchanged looks.
A lot had changed this past year. Some of it had been small, some of it had been big, and one bit was absolutely spectacular.
Here she is,
Nick said, coming back into the kitchen. There was a baby on his hip, clinging to his coat with her fierce little hands, looking around at us sleepily. Nick kissed her on the head.
I missed you, Eula Hall.
Chapter 2. Oh yeah, we have a baby sister. I don't mean to brag, but Eula is, without a doubt, the cutest and best baby sister there has ever been in the entire universe. She's round and squishy and has blonde wispy hair that sticks up in all directions like she's a cartoon scientist. Eula's voice has a good range. She makes little sing-song noises and can also bellow louder than a foghorn. She can crawl and pull herself upright on the furniture, and everything she set eyes on goes into her mouth. She's not quite 11 months old, but nevertheless, she completely rules our house. Nick covered Eula in kisses until she decided she'd had enough of his whiskers brushing against her cheek and grabbed a fistful of his beard. He went very still as she clung on with a vice-like grip.
Ouch!
Eula beamed and yanked harder. Nick's eyes started to water. She does that with my hair too, I said, wincing in sympathy. Eula finally decided to let go and gave a happy squeal, kicking her legs enthusiastically. She wasn't ready for walking quite yet, but she was doing plenty of leg exercises in preparation. Mum was busy baby-proofing the house from top to bottom. Will already had a lock on his door. Come and sit down, Nick. You've had a long flight, Mum said, leading the way into the glittering living room. I decided to put the kettle on to give Nick and Mum a moment with Eula by themselves. The problem with Nick's job was that sometimes he had to go back to the North Pole for a few weeks at a time. The official story, for anyone who asked, was that Nick spent time in Finland for work. Which was actually true. We just didn't mention the Father Christmas part. And we had learnt that there were all sorts of Christmassy things Nick had to be a part of before December, like toy manufacturing and delivery, sleigh improvements, caring for reindeer calves, dealing with emergencies at Tinsel, the International North Pole Sorting Envelopes Logistics Division, which handled the redirection of all the letters. Being Father Christmas was a job all year, not just on Christmas Eve. But even though it was tricky to organise sometimes, Nick made sure to come back to the UK at least once every 2 weeks to be with us. He'd promised he would, and so far, he was making good on it. Mum had taken time off when Eula was first born, but now that she was back to work full-time, she was as busy as ever. Plus, Eula had to be picked up from nursery before Mum's old finishing time, so now all of Mum's forms and veterinary notes came home with her to complete in the evenings, and she had to fit those around looking after Eula. Our lives had changed a lot, but it was a good kind of busy, the sort where there's always something to look forward to. Will brought his knitting bag in from the lounge and started sorting out his needles. The half a jumper he was working on dangled between them.
Maybe this jumper can be for Eula, he said, holding it up and looking at the size of it.
Or a hamster, I suggested, pouring water into the teapot. I piled digestive biscuits onto a plate and put it on the tea tray. Why don't you stick to making hats? The hats are great. The hats were not great, but they were very warm, despite looking like misshapen puddings. We all had one now, even Eula, though hers was miles too big for her.
I just wanted to try to do something a bit more complicated.
Will started counting stitches.
Knitting is meant to be good for your brain, so I thought it would help me with my puzzle cubing. I didn't realise it was going to consume my entire life.
He accepted his tea with a smile and frowned down at his project. I left him to it. The patterns looked more complicated than the coding lessons we had at school. In the living room, Nick and Mum were watching Eula speed crawl from one end of the room to the other. Everything looked very cosy. The Christmas tree was illuminated and twinkling with colourful fairy lights that seemed more sparkly than ever, making the framed pictures on the windowsill glow brightly. There were photos of me, Will, Mum and Nick at Lapland. Eula, 5 minutes after she'd been born, when she still looked like an angry turnip. Mum and Nick at the seaside. Me and Will dressed up in a lot of padded gear to play laser tag. And me on my 12th birthday going to see the Rainbow Cats at the East Midlands Arena. How were things at the North Pole, Nick? I asked, putting the tea tray down. Nick gave a resigned sort of groan.
Busy. The sleigh is still over there. The tech team at HQ want to make some anti-drone modifications. People keep inventing new technology that I have to try and avoid.
I wanted to laugh. It was funny to think of Father Christmas trying to avoid being spotted by a drone swerving around the skies. With all the satellites and cameras around, it was a wonder he managed to get away without being detected at all. Don't you ever get seen? I asked.
Occasionally. It's not always a problem. It depends who I'm seen by,
he said, reaching for one of the biscuits that had silently transformed into Christmas tree shapes the moment I brought them into the room.
Children see me flying past? No problem. Someone films me on their phone? Huge incident.
What happens then? I asked, imagining alarms and flashing lights and elves in jumpsuits running towards helicopters.
The communications team usually make sure it's dismissed as a hoax,
Nick said, dipping his biscuit.
They have elves posing as human video experts who claim the footage has been altered. It's a bit of a fib, but necessary. If everyone figured out who and where I am, Christmas could be ruined.
I figured it out, I said, a bit smugly.
Yes, but you're smart,
Nick said.
And I was living in your house, which gave you a little advantage.
But what if someone else figures it out? I asked. Like a stranger. Nick lifted Eula onto his lap, and she promptly stole the last half of his biscuit.
I don't even like to think about it,
he said.
That could mean the end of Christmas as we know it.
Chapter 3. I was woken by the familiar, delicious scent of gingerbread drifting through the air from the kitchen. I smiled into my pillow, feeling like Christmas had truly begun. Nick's festive biscuits were always perfect. The right balance of crunchy and soft. The spices just ideal, the amount of chocolate chips just what you wanted, and he never used a shape cutter either. Just traced a flat knife through the dough into the exact shape he wanted. And they never went all blobby in the oven, like when me and Will tried to do snowmen, and they came out looking like shortbread splats. I let my nose lead me downstairs. Mum had gone to work already, and Will never rose before 10 at weekends, so it was just Nick and Eula downstairs. The older, trying to get the younger to eat a bit of Wheaty Brick cereal.
Mm.
Eula braced herself on the tray of her high chair and leaned away from the spoon as if it held horrors beyond human comprehension. "I don't blame her," I said. "The house smells of biscuits, and you want her to try something that looks like it's already been eaten once." Nick sighed and held the spoon out persistently.
"Are all babies like this?"
he asked. "No idea," I said, fishing out a box of cereal. "Don't you see a lot of babies on Christmas Eve?"
"They're usually asleep."
Nick decided to eat the spoonful of soggy wheat himself and gave a big, full smile.
"Delicious! If you don't have a sense of taste," he added.
Eula made grabbing gestures at the plate of buttered toast on the table, and Nick put some on the tray of her high chair. She promptly picked up two pieces and wiped them into her hair. Nick put his head in his hands. "Good luck," I said brightly, balancing a Christmas biscuit on top of my cereal and taking the whole thing into the living room. If Eula saw I was eating cocoa frosted Krispies, she'd shatter the windows screaming until she got some. Since Mum was at work, we were going to spend most of the day with Nick at his job. Or at least, the job he used as a cover story whilst he was incognito. We took the long route through the village so we could call into the library and the post office, get Eula settled at the new childminder, and most importantly, call into the cake shop. The council had put the village Christmas lights up at the end of November, and they glowed dimly in the December morning. There was going to be a parade on Christmas Eve to raise money for charity, and there were posters all over the village advertising stalls, games, a raffle, and a very special visitor.
"Nick, look!"
Will grinned as he pointed out the posters. There was a photograph of a man dressed as Father Christmas sitting on the back of a lorry that had been decorated to look like a sleigh if you stood about 30 metres away. The man was waving at the camera, his big fake beard over his nose and almost in his eyes. Nick snorted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.